right?
Yeah, in the true sense, right?
And in the true sense, because there's harmony and there's not harmony.
And when it's not,
it's bad. And when you sing too early in the silence, and you're the one guy that sings before the guy goes like this, you know?
Yeah, that's actually turned out to be a huge problem.
Right.
Like, it's really bad if you don't follow the notes to the D and everybody else is.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, timing. Good news.
Okay, let's see.
So it all went well. What's the end of the story?
That is the end of the story.
So you crushed it.
it went well. Crushed it in
short notice. Yeah. Right.
Thousand things I would do differently. I only got to sing one performance.
Uh-huh.
And I was the backup for the other guy for his like three performances. And but it was the biggest job I've had so far, and I'm really grateful that I got to have that experience.
Mm-hmm.
That's just.
But do you get to go back up there to finish it out? If it's not.
Oh, it's done.
Oh,
and that's the way the opera world is, especially in America. We do two weekends of shows, and it's over.
Do you feel that you are on better footing with this director?
No. She's a.
Yeah.
She's a mess.
Yeah.
So.
But did it went, like, the show went well, anything?
Has it gotten reviews yet?
Yes, we got a good review. They said nice things. But I think that the show was kind of like. The spirit of it, the collectively, we all were just like tired by the time we got to the show because of how emotionally exhausting she was to everybody. I was able to like overcome it the best I could, but I think a lot of people just, maybe not emotionally exhausted, but they just kind of checked out.
It's one of those things that like, I don't even want to do this for you anymore.
Uh-huh.
Is that the resulting feeling?
Oh, and there's a moment where we all switched, and it was like, we're
just going to get through this.
We're going to go our own way.
Just get through this, yeah.
We're out of the rehearsal room, and we're on the stage, and we're putting it all together on stage. And she's sending us notes every night through email.
Yeah.
And they were like, we're not even going to read them anymore. It's because
she fatigued too much.
And it's like crying wolf, and it's like just beating a dead horse. So, I don't know what the heck I have to do here.
Have you heard from Andrew? Is Andrew coming?
I think he might still have met up with him earlier this week, so.
Okay.
Yeah, cool. I think he's playing
again. How's his interviews going?
Unfortunately, my company messed up in the rooms, unfortunately. But yeah, he's now kind of more in the back of the search room.
Okay.
You guys are working in the same coding space?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's like technology and stuff.
Interesting.
So, mm-hmm.
Small world.
Yeah, really. He had a really good experience, though, in terms of the actual interview process and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I think he's in good spirits.
Yeah.
Just,
Was it a match that he tried to hire your firm?
Yeah.
Okay. I have not read, but I have seen in my Chrome recommendations several articles that are like laid out like the technology interviews for positions that are like, you know, those high income positions that involve coding. Like they're getting really ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like they're basically asking for a week of free work.
Or more. Yeah. Oh gosh. Yeah, that's the worst. I think a lot of companies are trying to move away from that, you know. It's still a pretty intense process. Like Andrew had at least five or six separate conversations as part of this process, you know. So it's like, it's pretty thorough. At least, you know, the companies that are.
Is it knowledge based? Or is it personality based too?
It's like a mix of like, kind of exercising like your coding ability, your understanding of like the system design, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And then at least my company, quite a bit of behavioral interview and stuff too. So basically, I think the better companies will have a good balance of both.
Is it going to go or not?
No.
Which one did you try?
Both.
Did you get to step three on the first one?
Mm-hmm. I entered the code like four different times.
You think from your phone? Have you tried from your phone?
Tried from my phone.
You have to be on the same Wi-Fi, right? Do you know which one this is on? Is it Boulder Gas?
On this one?
Yeah. That's
I don't know what Wi-Fi the TV is on.
What she said is you gotta know your router or something, or you gotta know your.
That's what she said.
She said you gotta know your domain.
I did not get it.
Domain name or your.
What?
That seems too complex.
That's silly. That should just work.
We're gonna do it.
So it's.
I have too many brain cells in this room to not outsmart this stupid TV. Mine are worthless, by the way. My brain cells. I can't contribute to this. Except motivation.
I subjected my brain cells to inundation this week. I had an MRI and an EEG.
Oh, no.
For your sleep.
Yeah.
Oh, sleep.
Sleep and memory. I think that I've got black mold that I've been living with for 3 years, and my memory's shot. I think I've got like a 10-day span.
Weird that the code doesn't work.
I thought you were going to say you have black mold in your brain, and I was about to laugh because I thought that was funny, but that's not what you said.
It's not funny because
that's not what you said at all.
What's happened.
Yeah.
The spores from black mold have been known to be really toxic to memory.
Do you know where this black mold's been?
Yeah, there's a massive, there's water damage in the wall of my unit. Like from the outside, there's clearly a masonry and a drainage. And it comes through, it comes through the wall. There's a crack in the wall that starts up here and goes like almost 5 feet.
Do you want me to represent you in court?
Huh?
I'd be happy to represent you in court.
I'm pretty close because I think that it would be a slam dunk. With regard to, like, their knowledge of it, I brought it to them, like, 3 times before they addressed it.
Over a period of how long? A year? Or
no, I brought it to their attention when I moved in, and they denied me, and I brought it to their attention again, like, this last...
Written?
In,
written record?
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
Huh.
So... I don't know.
That looks promising.
But I definitely need to get out. But I've heard that you can't like sue anybody after you've left. You sue while you're still living.
I wonder what kind of real estate lawyers I know. This feels really right.
Why did it just do that? What did we do?
It gave up. Well, he's going to be super pumped. Well, you know that's how it works, though. Like,
of course.
I said, I was at the office the other day, and I said, as soon as I go to take a shit, which I really had to do, my phone's going to blow up. And guess what?
It blew up.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I watched this episode of Cat Williams with... Or listen to that episode with Joe Rogan.
Uh-huh.
Dude, they got some crazy stuff with
Cat Williams. So, of course, you leave the room and it just starts working. So thank you for going on.
Yeah, no worries.
It's cool that there are so few of us, so we can have a chat.
Yeah.
Josh prompted me to just spin out some thoughts about life in the arts and our relationship to music, and of course I had so much fun just kind of letting my mind wander, because I have always felt like, you know, ever since I started studying classical music, that when I tell people, they ask me, what do you do? I'm like, I'm an opera singer. They go, oh, what? Oh. And it's something that's like left field, you know?
Yeah.
And so like just sitting and wondering like, okay, wait, what? We in our culture seem disconnected from high art.
True.
Or what used to be called high art.
Yeah.
And so why? And what's the state of art today? And there are people much smarter than me writing books and stuff about the state of the arts, but just sitting and thinking about it, a lot of really good things came to mind, but really, just first and foremost, even though our art culture has changed, art and beauty like don't change. The beautiful has always been there.
Yeah.
And so we being in and acknowledging our creator and coming to God and our life with him, we know that God is the ultimate source of beauty. He is beauty. Not just the source, but that God is beautiful. His law is beautiful. The gospel is so beautiful. And he is the source of beauty. We see it in our creation. Like this sunrise, a 70 degree day, a beautiful forest. It's like 6 a.m., it's a little foggy, and you see like the young deer like cross the road, and there's just like something indescribable about that, you know? Like I see the deer like running through the woods in my neighborhood, and it's just, and we just take a moment and we recognize it, and it's like, nice. So God is beauty. He's put his beauty into his creation. And man is the flower of creation, right? Man in the Garden of Eden sense is very beautiful. And through us, not just we are beautiful, but through us, God has given us power from him to create beautiful things.
Yeah.
And it is only from his power that we do such a thing, right? So this is just a train of thought that I'm leaving here to say what beauty is and where it comes from, right? And so I went to 6 years of music school plus high school. And I had to study music history and art history and music theory. And they teach you like the greatest of the greats from the beginning of Western music. And so sitting here thinking about, okay, how do I talk about classical music and what's our modern view of it? Like there used to be in the upper echelon of music making, utter, complete reverence for God. It's that same thing that we find out. It's that same thing that we find out when. When we learn about the great scientists who, and the guys who are the founding fathers of science, oh, turns out they were not atheists. They were actually...
A lot of times they were priests.
A lot of times they were priests and monks and outspoken Christians.
Mm-hmm.
And even Einstein himself, you know, talking about that the universe speaks of a creator. So, and what's amazing is, I go to school and I learn about Mozart, Beethoven, Brahms, Haydn, Handel, the men who shaped music and to whom we have to thank for all the music we listen to today.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I learned years later, all those men, devout Christians. Mm-hmm. Bach would sign every...
Yeah.
Piece of music, Soli Deo Gloria.
Mm-hmm.
Every piece of music, he wouldn't even sign his initials.
Only to God.
He would just sign, "To God be the glory."
Yeah.
Wow.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Really amazing. And so, but we sitting here don't even have to be, we don't even have to turn on the radio to know that music is different today.
Yeah.
Popular music. It's different, and why, what happened? It's all sexual, it's all me, it's all flash, it's all sensual, it's like about how it makes me feel.
Right.
So, and what changed? And I think that you can make the argument that it was in the, as an outpouring of the Enlightenment, right? The focus on, well, we're here and we just have to know what there is to be known, and it's focus on man, and it's like we're the peak of what is, and we're only going to be here for as long as we are, so it's like just learn everything you can. Isn't that great? And so this turn happened out of the Enlightenment, from making music, the classical music, the Romantic era, making music for God, and as an outpouring, like as out of the overflow of the heart, to like self, and I'm gonna just write stuff about my feelings. And
well, celebrity, right?
Yeah.
That's a big part of it.
Right, right.
Yeah, it's, you know,
the praise.
The glorification of the individual.
Yeah. Totally. And what does the Word of God say? Be. The praise of man is a snare.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah.
And so, there's this shift that happened, and what's more is, so I have some quotes from these Christian composers that I want to share with you that I think you're going to love, because I love them so much. But one of the quotes said, and out of all of them comes this sense that all of them believed that their music was spiritual. Like music is not just sound that you hear and it sounds nice. Like, what is music? It doesn't even make sense that it works. It's like math. Why does math just work? Kurt Vonnegut, our pride and joy of Indianapolis, one of the great authors of the last century, he was like, he had a quote that said, Let my tombstone say, the only proof he needed for God's existence was music.
Mm. Mm.
I was like, that's strong.
It is strong.
Mm. I'm like, okay, Kurt.
Mm.
Because music is this strange, beautiful thing. It's just notes and sounds, and you know when it sounds right, and it just gets you to your core, and it moves you, and so music if it's not just sound, what is it? And so they would argue, and I would argue, that music is 100% spiritual. And if that's the case, what spirit is in the music? Because it's we know, we've heard things, we've all heard things that are totally from the Spirit of God. It moves us, makes you tear up, gives you chills. But I would argue that the spirit of today is, and this spirit of selfishness and sensuality, is not just a spirit of the age, but it's Satan, who's deceiving us through the music to focus on ourselves and on our sensuality and do what you want and just feel good. So I think, and what's amazing is, it's obvious if you learn the greatest music of the greatest composers, and then you compare that music just qualitatively to the music of today, you know today's music is worse. Music, the quality is degrading. And I was talking to my friend about this subject, and he said something really profound that I really love, that Satan, the last thing he wants for us is to do anything to glorify God and to worship Him. And so making music in contrast to this demonic spirit that's overtaken the culture and the popular music, making music and saying, no, I'm not going to do it for me. I'm going to sing for God. I'm going to give the glory back to Him through what I'm doing, is actually an attack on Satan. It's actually an attack. It's on the offensive. And he hates it. So I love that, and I totally agree. So I want you guys to hear some of these amazing quotes from the composers. But first, C.S. Lewis, Weight of Glory. Familiar?
Never read it.
I haven't read it.
Amazing piece of work. It's an incredible argument for God that's baked into it, and also an expansion on the Romans verse that talks about the glory that's waiting for us with God in heaven. But there's a paragraph in here. So he talks about how let me just read this. In speaking of this desire for our own far-off country in which we find in ourselves even now, this inner longing, I feel a certain shyness. I'm almost committing an indecency. I'm trying to rip open the inconsolable secret in each one of you. The secret which hurts so much that you take your revenge on it by calling it names like nostalgia and romanticism and adolescence. The secret also which pierces with such sweetness that when, in very intimate conversation, the mention of it becomes imminent, we grow awkward and affect to laugh at ourselves. The secret we cannot hide and cannot tell, though we desire to do both. We cannot tell it because it is a desire for something that has never actually appeared in our experience. We cannot hide it because our experience is constantly suggesting it, and we betray ourselves like lovers at the mention of a name. Our commonest expedient is to call it beauty and behave as if that had settled the matter. Wordsworth's, another author, expedient was to identify it with certain moments of his own past. But all this is a cheat. If Wordsworth had gone back to those moments in the past, he would not have found the thing itself, but only the reminder of it. What he remembered would turn out to be itself just a remembering. The books or the music in which we thought the beauty was located will betray us if we trust to them. It was not in them, it only came through them. And what came through them was longing. These things, the beauty, the memory of our own past, are good images of what we really desire. But if they are mistaken for the thing itself, they turn into dumb idols, breaking the hearts of their worshippers. For they are not the thing itself. They are only the scent of a flower we have not found, the echo of a tune we have not heard, news from a country we have never yet visited.
Mic drop
for sure. And that says really well that what's the problem is when artists, creators, make it about, look at this thing, how perfect, and I made it. Look at me, I'm singing. Listen to me and what I made. When you make it about the thing itself, or the creator themselves, swing and a miss. And not just swing and a miss, it's, there's poison in that. Because we have all these things in our life that are good pleasures. Coffee.
Hell yeah.
Friends. A good meal. Intimacy with your wife. But if those are, if you take that thing and you like worship that thing, and you like put it on a pedestal on which it doesn't belong, not only is it a swing and a miss, it'll break you and your relationship to that thing. Because you will need it, and you'll need it to be a certain way, and you put, by putting it on a pedestal, you are, it crushes both you and the thing, because the thing is not then in its good, right place. A coffee can't just be a good coffee. That's all it is. But I need it. No. So, so just a few of these quotes. Love these so much. And then I want to tell you guys a bit about my story and my relationship to music. And then we can kind of chit-chat or listen to some things that I really love and I think you'll like.
Love this guy's profile up there. He looks like you're Val Kilmer.
He does! He does! I always do that, but I never put it together. Amazing Russian baritone. Love this guy. So, Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, the father of music theory, the father of knowing which note comes after what note. He said, music's only purpose should be for the glory and the recreation of the human spirit. The glory of God and the recreation of the human spirit, period. Love it. Music is an agreeable harmony for the honor of God and the permissible delights of the soul. Love it. Franz Joseph Haydn, in speaking about composing one of his greatest works, which was a, I don't know if you guys have ever been to like Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, but you'll see, instead of like an opera or a play where people are on stage acting, they all stand up there in their tuxedos, and then there's the orchestra behind them, and then they all just stand and sing, you know? There's no acting, it's all music. Mm-hmm. But instead of just an orchestra, there are singers in front of the orchestra. So he was composing this work called The Creation, which is about creation. And I just love this. All of these are, I read these and I think of how contrasting it is to the leading musicians of today. You know, Haydn said, "Never was I so devout when I composed The Creation. I knelt down each day to pray to God to give me strength for my work. When I was working on The Creation, I felt so impregnated with divine certainty that before sitting down to the piano, I would quietly and confidently pray to God to grant me the talent that I was needed to praise Him worthily."
awesome, but also sad, because there's a whole lifetime after composing.
Exactly, but it wasn't. He's not even taking the credit.
No.
So he's kneeling down and he's like, I know that this music is from you and for you, God. Give me the strength and the talent to do it, and then I give it back to you. So that then, really, then there is no mountaintop.
Right, we're just channels.
We're just channels. We're just doing it for him. We're just vessels.
Surprisingly simple.
Surprisingly.
We make it very hard.
I have a question.
Please.
Along that line. What, that's Hayden.
Yeah.
Hayden.
What can allow Hayden, Bach, etc., operate this way? Is it, do you think it's baked into their culture, baked into their, like, it's just, it's there, it's part, they're a product of their age, and it's just naturally flowing through them? Or are they especially trained in a spiritual sense to access music in that particular way, or their profession in that particular way? Be it, you mentioned Einstein earlier, or, you know, Descartes, or whomever.
I like this question. Yeah. Yeah, so I've thought about this a lot, because in thinking about the difference between the classical age of not just of music, but of art generally, painting, sculpture, the Florentine burst of art creation, and then comparing that age to ours, what are the material differences in the way that we live? And yeah, you can point at your phone and say this thing, but what are the implications of the fact that we have these? Our time is taken, number one. We have so much less time thanks to these. And we, with an excess of access, comes a strange, like, complacency and boredom, almost. Like, because you have everything, you don't do as much, it seems to me. What I'm saying is, when I learned about the great opera singers who I admire from 100 years ago.
100 years ago. That was my next question.
Yes.
Was, okay, when was art, like, slowing, like, declining?
Good question. I think, in my opinion, music has been declining slowly more and more for the past 100 years.
For sure.
These phones came up 15 years ago.
True. I'm comparing the extremes. Looking at the process.
That's fine.
I think part of it is also...
The World Wars, big, right?
The World Wars, for sure. But also,
a lot of shit changed as a result of the world wars.
Right. Well,
especially
and,
like yeah. Okay. Sorry.
And no. And this is good because you're helping me flesh it out. Because this is a lot of this is just things I'm putting together. Because the precursor to this was the telephone and the telegram and.
And the phonograph,
record
music too, right?
Right. Right. That came at the turn of the 1900s, and international travel became easier with the creation of the airplane and especially the commercial airplane, and so that we have a through the last 100 years. If we haven't had this, we've had a more interconnected world. And with the Industrial Revolution, we have this creation of the 9-to-5 and the creation of the middle class. Mm-hmm. And what is it? What does this mean, the middle class? And so, again,
rather than saying middle class, the working class.
Yes, that's what then.
It was just like putting in their time at work and. Mm-hmm.
But not that that's bad. I mean, everybody has worked always.
Of course, and it's but life looked a lot different.
But not on an assembly line, not in an industrial revolution sense.
You were a serf on somebody's land.
Yeah,
for sure. Well, and but now that there are people working at factories and there's this establishment of this working class. There's less of this like stark divide between the haves and the have-nots. There's this creation of something in the middle. But the point is, and I think this will express kind of what I'm trying to get at. The singers that I admire from the first recorded tenor. Who was recorded in like 1901 or 1900 or 1902 from Italy? He was recorded on, you know, on wax. His whole life was devoted to singing. Devoted, like, and the tradition was going back further than the first recorded tenor. If you were going to be an opera singer. You would go and live with your teacher and wake up, study, eat, coffee, study again in the afternoon, eat, have a little sing in the evening with him, talk late at night, go to bed, do it all again.
But that was fueled by a series of patronages, right?
Not exactly.
So you had to have prospects for making money.
Uh-huh.
Like you could otherwise, you're just in the poorhouse together with wishful thinking as your companion.
True. And most of the time it was the teacher who had patronages, who was already an established musician,
mm-hmm.
by the state or by the
church,
the monarchy or by the church, and who had a nice enough place and had, now that they're established and have this patronage, they would be able to take on a student like that.
Right.
They would find a protege.
So we're talking like right now, this is like, because your question was about the 17th century.
Well, it's the same as the reading that we did with Augustine. Like he's got his seminarians in the house with him.
Yes.
Yeah.
And he's training them up. They're destined to be priests or whatever.
Right.
Yes.
These guys are destined to be opera singers.
Right.
More or less.
So, and your question was, what do they have? What
was baked into the fabric of like what they did that gave them the mindset of
they couldn't
glorify God.
Yeah.
Right.
My talents need to be attenuated to the purpose.
Right.
Glorifying.
Thank you, because I couldn't remember the question. This is just me spinning a yarn. But so, essentially, there's a long way of displaying the difference in the culture was that when you were decided to become this, this was all that you did. If you were so lucky to become a protege and to get a teacher, and not just, or you were a rich kid who got the lessons and.
Mm-hmm.
Mommy sends me to lesson. It's a similar thing, but so if you are lucky enough to do that, then and if you didn't just, this is like shifting from, oh, I got piano lessons from the local teacher
mm-hmm.
in the neighborhood when I was a kid. This is shifting from that to like, this is what my life is about. I'm going to the university, you know, which they did have. And
so it's built into the culture of music.
It's built into the culture of music for them that once you go in, you're going all the way in.
But after the French Revolution, after the American Revolution, after like the tail end of the Enlightenment going into the World Wars, things flip upside down.
Yes, especially after the World Wars.
Because it becomes a more individualized culture.
Yes, totally a more individualized culture, and also
a rejection of the church.
Yes, yes. So that was another thing that wasn't mentioned in that. Because, like, in New York City, the creation of New York City, right, to be what it is, this hub of everything, you know, for the longest time, it was just a hub of, like, prostitution and drugs. But because being like looking at Bach and Brahms and Beethoven and Mozart, there it was baked into the culture that they would entirely devote themselves to what they did, and they were devout Christians. So this is why we hear this from them. And there was no such thing as an internet celebrity. They did have famous people,
mm-hmm.
but I think fame was obviously different than we imagine it now. It was more in the air somewhere, rather than, look at this on the screen, whoa, there they are. Look at them in the magazine, wow, they're so beautiful. So somewhere along the line it changed to where, yes, now the city and the culture shift, the spirit shifts underneath it, where thanks to the Enlightenment, thanks to advancements, and man gets to the moon, and man is like coming into his own. We forget what it's for, and we start making music for ourselves, and we start making music, and then the growth of celebrity, and it all shifts, and now it's, and I don't know exactly what each cause was and what each shift was, but it definitely got worse and worse.
I seriously think that the late 1800s, 1870
mm-hmm.
to 1910,
mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
as the wars were coming, there was something universally, like Western Europe, you know, and West, was just like eating away at the, like, there was just something in the air of like, fuck, we've got our first world war is on the horizon. Nobody knew that, of course.
Well,
no, they
predicted.
They did.
Yeah. Well, and so there's all this tension in Europe that's like, and so all the great philosophers, meaning Josh's favorite philosophers, are all in that time period of existential dread.
Yes.
And everything's coming to an end.
Yes.
They're not talking like this, but
no.
Like, but my life, like we've talked about, like Camus' famous first line of the Myth of Sisyphus is, there's but one true philosophical question, and that is suicide.
Yeah.
You know? And so it's like, when that is there, and you're talking about yourself ending yourself.
Yes.
The individual.
Yes.
There's no Christian, I mean, except Kierkegaard, but there's no Christian existentialist. Dostoevsky. But they're all like fuckheads that are trying to make it work without, like, or they're not, and they're trying to like abolish it.
Yes, and that's one of the things about existentialism, it seems to me, is that it's pointed this way. It's a little bit like this. And it depends on what kind of existentialist we're talking about, because there's the existentialist who's like, my brain is the only one that exists, I'm just kind of experiencing everybody else.
Yeah.
But they did predict it.
Yeah.
Like,
oh yeah,
Nietzsche, Dostoevsky.
Yeah. Multiple accounts
before
of
the wars happened.
Say, oh yeah, they all say that there was something in the air.
Yeah.
Like, I can't remember this guy's name, but he has something called like the Epic History Podcast or something. I can't remember what it's called, but this guy does these super deep dives into history that are like, it, you know, 6 to 9 hours of media that you have to consume, where he's got a team that's built up like this whole like narrative by plumbing all of the available historical resources. And one of the ones that I listened to was on World War One, and that's the sentiment that comes across over and over again was that they all had this awareness that there was something in the air, and that they just knew that it was just, you know, it was kindling. Everything was dry, and it was just going to take the strike of a match before it all went up in flames. So it was like they had a sense that they, like, there were wolves everywhere around them.
Yes.
And that those wolves literally threw the masses of Europe into the grinder of World War One, where millions and millions died, because it was the first time they could. It was the first time that they could just like create like assembly line type of wars, and just it's amazing and terrifying.
Wow, it is terrifying, and Nietzsche lamented it. He knew it was coming, and he was like, the bottom has fallen out from under everything.
Yeah.
God is dead, and we have killed him.
Yeah.
It's on us, because we've forgotten. And Dostoevsky wrote amazing books, and his, in the Brothers Karamazov, amazing book, and he wrote a book called Demons. He was like, if there's no God, man will just run rampant. Then if there's no God, there's no rules. If there's no rules, then everything is up for grabs, right?
Okay.
And his book Demons was really about like what happens when an idea that sounds good actually gets fleshed out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
It's like the utopian thing, you know?
Sure.
Like the idea of utopia.
Mm-hmm.
We all live together and share everything, and we all agree, and everything's for everybody. Sounds great.
Mm-hmm.
Until it doesn't, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And,
That reminds me of, a bunch of us went to go see Jordan Peterson when he was in town.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
He was here?
He was here just a couple weeks ago.
Wow!
But that reminds me of, like, one of the things that Jordan Peterson was talking about is the danger of consensus.
There we go.
Right? And, like where truth, consensus can be confused for truth. You know, so if the masses come to arrive at some sort of, let's say, disoriented view, and life, existence, and that becomes the norm. You know, everyone can look at that and say, "Oh, well, that must be true because everyone believes that." You know, you know,
like
that can be so dangerous.
Wow, that's really good.
Yeah.
Well said. Have you read Demons?
No,
Dostoevsky.
I haven't read anything by him front cover to cover. Notes from the
jerk.
Notes from the Underground. Not
you
any of his longer pieces. Not even his smaller pieces. It's fucked.
Does he have one called The Idiot? Or
yep.
The
yes.
Adolescent?
Yep.
So,
is it The Idiot or The Adolescent?
It's The Idiot.
The Idiot. I've heard that one's really good.
It's very good. It's very interesting. I learned a lot because it taught me a lot about my people-pleasing nature and how that can really go bad he's Christ without the divinity, meaning the turning the other cheek and the just letting everybody, like, taking everybody else's flack and mistakes and everybody just kind of uses him.
Yes.
All his relationships, he just gets used and he's just like the ultimate make no waves and just people pleaser. And it all goes horribly because he won't actually choose to like take a stand for himself. has no idea. And it's
and it's called the idiot.
Yeah.
He's just an idiot.
No, because he's like simple. He's like, sure, whatever you want.
Wow.
That's like who he is.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well,
and it's incredible how bad it gets for him. But Demons is amazing.
It's
about what happens when.
And it's not long. I know it's short, right? Demons is short.
Yeah,
it's one of the short ones.
No, it's not.
It's not
short.
It's Fat Boy.
It's a full novel. It's a full novel.
Like,
but
not as long as Brothers Karamazov.
It's almost as long as Brothers. But come on, dude! You would love this. You would love it.
All
right. I know that you're correct. Like, I know at my core that you're...
Okay.
You don't
okay.
have to convince
Someday
me.
You'll come around.
But
yeah.
there's
right
a
now,
million other pieces of media.
Right now I'm reading comic books.
All right. just a reminder, if
yes.
you guys care to write it down, the history podcast I was talking about, Dan Carlin does he's got a whole media platform called Hardcore History. And back in 2014 or 15, he did something called The Blueprint for Armageddon. And it is really, really good. It's about the end of the Prussian Empire and how the assassination of Franz Ferdinand was almost insanely providential. It was providential. It was just astonishing, like the kinds of things that had to come together to make it possible. Really cool, really, really cool. Also, you will cry. If you don't cry, you're not human. Can we listen to this guy? I've been admiring his face for the last
Let's jump back on track. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, it's okay.
I'll
we
save my questions
this
for the
guy.
End.
I want the. This is like, I'm keeping you on the hook.
Yeah. This is Hardcore History?
Hardcore History.
Yeah, Hardcore History.
There's a couple that I
found
this in.
So, but that was what Nietzsche and Dostoevsky were warning about, and what he's warning through Demons and Brothers is like, this is what happens without God.
Yeah.
When we think our idea is the best, and we say I make my own rules. I mean, Crime and Punishment.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, he's like, well, I hate this woman,
mm-hmm.
and I want her stuff,
mm-hmm.
and, well, there's no God, so there's no rules, so I'll kill her.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's Crime and Punishment.
But there's even more than that, right? There was,
yes.
Because what he was obsessed with was why is Napoleon getting away with murder?
Wow, yeah, wow.
That was his background. He
wow.
He believed that if...
Are you talking about the character or just
the character?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he believed that if he thought about it hard enough and actualized it, that maybe he would be able to get away with it.
Yeah, he really thought he would.
It's amazing. So tell me what to read. Tell me if you haven't read it before.
All right, I'm just
he talks himself into it.
Yeah, he does.
It's crazy.
It is crazy. And reading it, you're like, I see where you're going with this.
And what's amazing?
And you're going to kill somebody now.
Totally. And he does it, and it's one of the best examples of like the inciting incident is at the very beginning, and then the rest of it is just like wow.
What's
amazing is my friends who were totally secular, and I lived with them in New York City. It's a couple, Will and Nicolette. She read this book because I was reading Dostoevsky. She read Crime and Punishment. There's a moment in there where there's this scene and. They are talking about Lazarus, and I don't remember exactly what the scene is, but it struck her that there was this moment in the book of like catharsis or something, and where the characters Raskolnikov and a woman have an emotional scene, and they're talking about Lazarus and Jesus, and Nicolette was like, I wonder what that story says. So she like opens up the Bible to like read the story of Lazarus, and then she's talking to it with her boyfriend, and then they're sitting on the couch one day and they're like, you want to read the Bible? And he's like, yeah. And they literally start from Genesis.
Dang,
and start reading the whole Bible, and they told me about it, and I ended up reading it with them, and they ended up coming to Christ. It's really incredible, all from Crime and Punishment.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Hell yeah, literature.
Hell yeah, literature. Yeah. I got two more quotes, and then I'll tell you a little bit about myself, and then we'll get to the good stuff. Martin Luther, the great Martin Luther on music. Next to the word of God, music deserves the highest praise. She is mistress and governess of those human emotions, to pass over the animals, which govern men as masters, or more often, overwhelm them. Emotions which govern men as masters, or more often, overwhelm them. No greater commendation than this can be found, at least not by us, for whether you wish to comfort the sad, to terrify the happy, to encourage the despairing, to humble the proud, to calm the passionate, or to appease those full of hate. And who could number all of these masters of the human heart, namely the emotions, inclinations, and affections that impel men to evil or good? What more effective means than music could you find? Mm. Nice.
That's a pretty good quote.
It's great. And this quote to me from Brahms is the coup de grace. He's writing to a journalist in 1896 in this period here. I will now tell you and your young friend here about my method of communicating with the infinite. For all truly inspired ideas come from God. Beethoven, who was my idol, was well aware of this. When I feel the urge, I begin by appealing straight to my maker. Straight away, the ideas flow in upon me directly from God, and not only do I see distinct themes in my mind's eyes, but they are clothed in the right forms, harmonies, and orchestration. You see, the powers from which all truly great composers like Mozart, Schubert, Bach, and Beethoven drew their inspirations is the same power that enabled Jesus to do miracles. I know several young composers among us who are atheists. I have read their scores, and I assure you, Joseph, that they are doomed to speedy oblivion because they are utterly lacking in inspiration. Their works are purely cerebral. The great Nazarene, Jesus, knew that law also, and he proclaimed it in John 15:4. The branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine. No atheist has ever been or ever will be a great composer.
Wow. Wow.
Branch.
Fine.
Vine.
Yeah.
Fruit.
Yeah.
Why is music, why does most popular music feel so fruitless?
Yeah.
Because it is.
Yeah. It's disconnected.
It's like, I'm a branch. I make fruit all on my own. You know? Look at me. Who needs a tree when you're a branch?
That's cool.
So that's my treatise on music and what it's for, why. Because if you would have asked me 10 years ago, Ganson, why are you a musician? When I first was getting into it, I would have been like, because I'm good at it.
Sure.
And even if you would have asked, you would have asked me, maybe I wouldn't have said that, but it was under the surface.
Sure.
I was chasing, wow, you're good at this.
Oh, yeah.
I'm familiar with that. Wow. Oh, you're talented. You're going to be, you got potential. You're going to go places. Mm-hmm. And so that thing. Because now I'm talking not about what the art world, whether the art, the music world is serving God or serving itself. I'm talking about me. And whether I'm doing it to serve God or to serve myself.
Yeah.
And this flesh and spirit, flesh and spirit, this is the pendulum that, you know, I used to write down all the affirmations that people, someone I looked up to in the business, someone I admired, would say something nice to me. Like, you're going to, oh, you're such a great musician. Your voice is love. I'm writing it down. I'd be like, yeah, this is true. This is me. And I started to just like rely on nice things that people say about me.
Yeah.
About my singing. And then every time I would sing, I would hope to get that. And in fact, I would wait for it after the performance. I'd be like, anybody have anything nice to say? Come on! And then I went through this process of like, wait a second, I need to let go of that. And I'm actually doing this for God's glory. And then I would go perform. And then I would get worried and insecure. And then I would wait after the performance to hear nice things from people. And then I'd go home and I'd be like, wait a second. I need to just do it for God's glory. I'm just he's giving me a gift. I have to pay it back to him. And then I would go perform. And I would get weird. And I would do it for the applause and for my teachers to tell me that they like my singing. And I would wait for the nice things. And I'm like, Ganson! How many times do you have to learn this lesson?
Yeah.
And I just got back from Arizona. And I woke up the morning of my performance as Romeo. And I got in the shower. And I turned on my favorite worship playlist. And I'm listening in the shower. My God, what a beautiful day. The sun is shining. It's 60 degrees, 70 degrees here in Arizona. I get to go sing today. And this crazy director, I'm not doing it for her. And I don't need to impress my colleagues. I know what I'm doing, and I'm excited to go do it for you, God. And I was in such a great place. I was in the Uber, just looking out the window. Wow. And then I get in the theater, and I start to warm up a little bit, start to sing. And my voice is kind of feeling a little weird. And then I start to worry. And then the makeup lady comes in, and I'm like, she's got to do my makeup, but I just want to sing and make sure I hear my voice. And I start to get weird. And I start thinking, okay, what about my high A and my high B? And I don't know, am I going to be able to make it through the show? And are they going to like me? And then it comes over me. And then on stage, I'm feeling self-aware. And through the whole show, I have to like work through, wait a second, chill, Ganson. Chill. Don't you remember everything you said? Why is it possible for us to say the right thing? And Romans 7.
Yeah.
Anybody?
I
didn't even put this in my notes, but it's what it is. This is some of the most encouraging scripture of all time. Yeah. Romans 7:14. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold under sin. For I do not understand my own actions.
Oh, yeah.
I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate.
Yep.
Now, if I say that I'm doing the thing that I don't want, I am agreeing with the law, that it is good, that the law is good. So it is no longer I who do the bad thing, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh, I serve the law of sin. Doesn't that say it all? And this is just so, and it's so, because, you know, it turned out I got a good review. And the performance was fine. So I had nothing to worry about in the end. I got weird in the dressing room for no reason. And I'm like, wow, so humbling. And also, thank God that I find it to be a law that when I want to do it for myself, when I want to sing and get on stage in front of the camera, in front of the audience, when I want to do it for myself, God, it's funny, he almost literally just clips my Achilles heel. He just goes, let me just do you a favor. Because if I got weird and I had a perfect performance, that's the worst thing.
Yeah.
Don't give me what I want.
Yeah, it's reinforcing.
That's reinforcing. Because then I'm just going to make a practice out of that.
Right. So he chastises the ones he loves.
Yes. And he'll humble the proud. And raise up the humble. And so, thank God that he snips my... I almost feel it in my throat that when I'm singing, that when I want to do it for me, it's almost like it blocks. It's the weirdest thing, but praise God for that. So, the reason I brought this is the punchline. Have you heard of this? Every Moment Holy? We were talking about it a little bit. These are liturgies written by amazing Christian author, Christian organization. It's not something that evangelicals or Protestants are used to, but they're liturgies. They're prayers for specific occasions. So, just looking at the table of contents, there's a prayer for sunsets. A liturgy for before beginning a book. A liturgy for feasting with friends. The morning of a yard sale. And I love this because it's intentional. It's like, ooh, gives me something material to stop and mark a moment before I do something. There's one of them that's before having a cup of coffee.
Nice.
I love that! And there's one called Before Taking the Stage. Yeah. And of course, when I heard of this book, I was like, I gotta read it. I gotta see what it says. And, what have I to offer here that might sustain the souls of others? Alone, I have little more to show beneath this scrutiny of lights than my own pride and insecurity, my craving for praise, and my fear of rejection. Rather, let me offer something greater in this place, O Christ. As I step onto this stage, meet me amidst the wreckage of my ego and my woundedness, and through me give what I alone cannot. I offer to you all that I have, my talents, my training, the years spent honing and crafting and creating, my passions, my personality, my history, the many sacrifices I and others have made in order for me to be here. I give you even my brokenness, of which I'm also a steward. I offer now these incomplete and insufficient provisions, remembering how you, in your days among us, twice blessed inadequate offerings, fashioning them into miraculous feasts that would sustain crowds in their hard journeys. I pray that you would likewise receive and bless and multiply my own meager gifts, Jesus, for the benefit of all who have gathered here. Let these humble elements in your hands become a true nourishment for those who hunger for you, and for those who have not yet awakened to their deepest hungers. Let my brief service to them be like the opening of a window through which the breezes of a far-off country might blow, stirring eternal longings to life. Take this tiny heap of my talents and my brokenness alike, this jumble of what is best and worst in me, and meld it together to the greater work of your Spirit, using each facet as you will, so that even as sunlight coursing through a cracked prism, your grace might somehow be revealed upon this stage in whatever glory and peculiar patterns you have fashioned me to display. Amen. And it is so funny. I mean, this thing, it's just, this feels like a gift to have these words expressed so perfectly. And I have them on my phone and I have them with me. I love this prayer so much because I always will need this or something very much like it in order to even dare to approach the stage. Because the moment I want to do it and do it right is the moment that I want to do it for me. It's like my flesh always wants to do it for me. So I love this prayer. Wanted to share that. Those are my thoughts on life and music.
Excellent.
Any thoughts? Any jump things jumping out? Any ideas or questions?
It reminds me of a surrender prayer. You know, like there's this guy who was a priest to one of our great sages of the 20th century. His name was Padre Pio.
Yeah.
And he's a saint, so he demonstrated a bunch of mystical qualities. Like, he had the stigmata his whole life after, like, 18, I think, 18 or 20. So he had wounds that bled and wept. That corresponded to the wounds of Christ, and he was absolutely mortified by them. He was embarrassed, so that whenever he was at liturgy, if you ever see pictures of him, he usually has like white bandaged gloves on, so he'll be holding, like, you know, in the liturgy of the Mass, there's like the consecration of the elements. You have the bread and the wine, and there's that moment where the priest is doing the elevation.
Yes.
So it's a beautiful scene, it's a beautiful image, and there's some pictures of him like this. But there's a guy who was his spiritual director. His name was Father Delindo, and he wrote, or received inspiration to write a bunch of prayers on surrender. And so, like, it's like a novena, and the Catholic tradition, it's common for there to be like a 9-day prayer that sort of has a fruition after the 9th day. There's a promise that a spiritual blessing, an outcome of that you're hoping for. And the witness of millions of people who have tried these novenas testifies that they are fruitful, that many people receive special graces, there's miraculous healings, there's changed lives. So it's a really cool pattern, but it sets your mind on particular pattern of thought. And so he wrote this novena where there's like this discourse with Jesus, where Jesus talks about how we want things, but we don't want to hear what he has to say. So we tell him what we imagine to be the best thing instead of asking him what the best thing is. And so the culmination of every prayer is, Jesus, you take care of it. That's the prayer. That's it. So at the end of everything, it's like it goes through. Jesus kind of gives you some spiritual counsel for 9 days, and this in the voice of Jesus, and sort of like, and it's, and it, you know, kind of conforms to the gospel. So it's a reflection, and he, you know, had an inspiration. It would be no different than a music, you know, like somebody writing lyrics in the voice of Jesus. And so these 9 days, every prayer ends in it. Jesus, you take care of it. Jesus, I'm here. It sucks. Jesus, you take care of it. I don't know what to do. You take care of it. I'm in misery and sorrow. You take care of it. Like, as soon for 9 days, you say this prayer, and then like that lasts. So it's an abandonment prayer.
It's a divine providence prayer. It's like a, hey, I'm your vessel type of prayer. And that's beautiful. That sounds similar. It's like, take everything that I've got, and then you do what, like, you meant for it to,
yes,
like, give, make the outcome that you intended from it.
Yes, yes. I love that. And this is like a shortened version.
Yeah.
Like these little, this prayer and the other ones, these little moments to, I'm giving this over. I'm not just asking, hey, give me, make me this.
Yeah.
But I'm giving. That's what I love so much about this, and what I think about anytime I even think about this prayer is those words, meager gifts, and meager elements.
Yeah.
Like this, all I've got, Lord, is 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's literally all I've got.
Yeah.
Here, you take care of it, right? And he does the multiplying, and he does what he will with it. And it's not, I really want this to, can I really please just have, you know? So totally. And it's this, and that's what I picture every time. I'm like, wow, wait a second. That really is all I'm bringing to the table. I'm not the miracle. Hello? As much as my ego wants to be,
yeah,
I'm just a guy who can make some sounds on a stage. And it's like, I can't be the one to make the miracle.
Yeah.
I just can't.
Yeah, and then you contextualize yourself. Like, you know, like a reminder of, like, how many have come before, how many will come after.
Absolutely.
How many ever get remembered.
Right.
And then you're like,
absolutely.
Oh, okay, actually, you know, this is a moment of brevity and leisure for many of these people.
Absolutely. And I love that I know that they took inspiration from that C.S. Lewis book.
Oh, for sure, the one that you began with.
Breathing longings,
yeah,
longings to life.
Yeah.
Like it's, like, for those who don't know God in the audience, maybe, like, through this, like through a window,
yeah,
the eternity will somehow blow into their hearts somehow.
Yeah.
Really love that.
That's cool.
Yeah. Thoughts?
Can you sing?
My gay music teacher,
mm-hmm,
in college, freshman year, it was like a prereq class, or like one of, you could choose, like, said I was a protege, but he was also very attracted to
you
me.
You mean
prodigy. And I have suspicions that he had ulterior motives.
It happens.
There's this like spot in my range that I can't settle into.
I know what that is.
And so I either have to go higher or I have to go lower. And I don't, it's very uncomfortable. Like even at church, I'm like, I'll get midway through, the refrain happens, and I'm like,
and it varies.
Now I have to go back down.
Yeah.
And I don't know if anybody else around me is listening, but this is awkward for me.
kind of drop an octave or drop an octave.
Is that something that can be trained through?
Absolutely. I'm still trying to figure that out. It's called the Italians have a word for it. It's called the passaggio, which means the passage or the passageway through and between two different registers, your lower and your upper register.
Wow.
And so there's this space in between where the voice has to actually narrow, and you can't do that by squeezing or by pushing. And so you have to train this balancing act of breath and word and space and freedom and all this stuff. And it takes years and years and years.
I've never said that out loud. I've always just dealt with it.
Totally what it is.
It makes me feel so much better.
First thing that I started learning.
I have a bunch of music questions, like how to listen to music.
Yeah.
But do you want those now, or do you want...
Let's have questions, yeah.
Well, what do you listen to? Like, on the drive here, what did you listen to?
Good question. On the drive here, I was listening to, like, a podcast, I think.
What music do you listen to?
When I listen to music, I listen to one of a few things. I listen to Steely Dan. I listen to certain pop music that really touches me and moves me. And I listen to, like, new jazz, because jazz to me is not just, you could almost say everything about jazz that I've said today, about classical music. One of the greatest Christian jazz albums is Coltrane's A Love Supreme.
Cool.
The inner fold of A Love Supreme is an entire paragraph dedicating the whole album to God.
Beautiful, wow.
It's incredible. John Coltrane, Love Supreme. And jazz is also to me one of these high arts.
Yeah.
Deep-seated tradition. Love it so much, which is also why I love Steely Dan, because they come out of jazz and also rock.
Yeah.
They really do something amazing. It fascinates me. And also, having studied music for so long, this might tell you something. I studied music theory and sight reading and ear training for so long that I got bored of... I would listen to music and I would just... It would be like an ear training exercise.
But it's one of my other questions, if it was like hard for you to listen to...
Yeah, and it's not like hard in a way where I'm like, oh, this is so simple, it's so bad.
Yeah.
No, I just hear the notes like I was trained to do.
Yeah,
right. I'm like, okay, one chord, six chord, two chord, four, five, one. Mm-hmm. Okay, great, we're back. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, and so that was what was cool. I wasn't trained in jazz. So that's why I love it, because I don't know what I'm hearing. For the most part, like, I can, it depends. But if it's like really out there, I'm like, cool, I don't know what I'm hearing, I love it. You know, I know it sounds right, and I can kind of guess where the one is, but
Do you have a hot take on any pop artists right now that's like actually worth listening to? I'm looking for something like, man, fucking Katy Perry, you gotta listen to her. Or
Molly Birch
or Kanye West, or like,
are you talking about popular artists? John Batiste is amazing.
Yeah.
Obviously, Jacob Collier is an incredible musician.
Lofi? Do you have opinions on Lofi?
Lofi?
She's an Icelandic. She sings like in the pattern of like mid-century pop. She uses the language of Gen Z, and she is really good.
How do you spell it?
L-E-O-F-I, I think. Leo. It looks like Leofi.
Okay.
I might have butchered it.
John Mayer.
John Mayer, incredible guitarist, incredible musician. And here's the thing. Something else I haven't talked about is, like, and I guess something I haven't touched on as much, but I did at the beginning. Okay, I said music is like math, right? Math has an incredible symmetry. If you ever heard of the Mandelbrot set, it's like this kaleidoscope. It's an algorithm that just gets displayed, and you can just zoom in, and it's always the same shape, and it's like, whoa, what? So music is like that. Music is symmetrical, especially Western music. Like the fathers of music discovered that music was chaos. No, it was order, and then chaos that comes back to order. And
like
there's
a consistency.
Yes, and that there's such thing as a shape, mm-hmm. and not just a shape, but you can have the most beautiful shape. In fact, you can have what seems to be perfection mm-hmm. in music, which is why I think these men speak of music in the way they do, mm-hmm. that it is spiritual, and that it is from God, because it seems as though music can be perfect, created by imperfect beings, so it can't come from us. That's why music is from God and can be spiritual. And so, pop songs, although not classical and uptight and whatever, like the old way they did it, they can be perfect. No one made as many perfect songs as Stevie Wonder. To me, Stevie Wonder, one of the best. We all know I Wish and Sir Duke and Superstition, but if you go and listen to his album starting when he got his, it was in the 70s when he became an independent artist and started writing his own music and wasn't forced to do what the label was telling him to do. Mm-hmm. The first one was Music of My Mind. If you start with that album and just listen to the whole album, and listen to all of Songs in the Key of Life, and listen to Inner Visions. These are perfect songs, and they're so perfect. They're such... I remember going through them for the first time and being like, God gave him those songs. Those songs weren't made up by Stevie Wonder. He discovered them. And there's a difference.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And that's amazing to me. And that's why music is so, like, it's the same with the great composers. Like, music is, like, found, and it's given, not from you.
Great composers being Paul McCartney, Ringo.
Yeah. Those songs that they wrote were discovered, you know?
I took a note to send this to you later. I'll put it in the chat. But there's an interview between Rick Rubin and John Mayer, and
I like Rick Rubin.
Both of them. A lot of the episodes in the Rick Rubin podcast talk about this. Like, art is a discovery. It's no invention. There's no invented quality to it. It's just get out of the way and let it flow. Like. And John Mayer picks up his guitar and just like, he's like, I'm not even playing right now.
Yeah.
He's like, I literally don't feel myself playing.
Yes, and that's the dangerous thing, because again, music is spiritual, mm-hmm. and if you are only of the flesh and you're only doing it to say, oh, I'm not even playing, look at me. Like, you are,
I'm over
it. What spirit is taking over and speaking through you?
The intentionality of the episode of the interview, I did not get that vibe. Like, I thought, oh, he's actually illustrating what you're talking about.
Oh, wow.
Like, there's this passageway that he's like accessing, like a divine passageway which he's accessing.
Nice.
I have to pee again.
Nice.
do you ever listen? Have you ever heard of Bella Fleck? Is bluegrass ever on your radar?
No, I don't know. I never got into bluegrass. It's that's just a taste thing. I liked a little bit back in the day, but
do you, do like Jeff Lynne and ELO, Electrified Orchestra.
Yeah, ELO, wow. Yeah, I had a big, they're like from the...
I think they had like all through the 70s. And
yeah,
maybe a couple of
I had a big 70s phase.
For sure. What's interesting about them is if you listen to some of their songs, like Mr. Blue Sky?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mr. Blue Sky has so, tonally, has so many experimental sounds and effects that have been added in that it feels like a song that's just been mixed out of a studio today.
Wow.
There's no...
Yeah.
There's no auto-tuning, but I think otherwise, like, there's a couple of moments where you're like, this sounds so fresh.
Yes.
Like, how did they come up with this?
Yeah, that's how I feel about 10cc. They did a 10cc did a great song called. It was a band from a similar time, and they were really artists. I'm Not in Love.
Oh my gosh, that song.
10cc is great.
I think I've heard of it.
Anyway, my turn to pee. Talk about this. Is it to the right here?
It's on the other side of this wall.
I stumbled into a music theory YouTube about 4 years ago, and I've been watching like some of these guys have like music. They just do video essays on music theory every now and then. So there's a few of them that are really fun to listen to. I don't know that I've actually learned anything other than to like kind of use their language or like parrot their talking points, but. It's like a secret club. Like you feel like if you're listening to these music theorists, you're like, oh, what's going on? And this the same thing is like he mentioned Jacob Collier. Jacob Collier it has probably the closest thing that I've ever seen to total recall memory. That's demonstrable. So it's like it's a savant level of music knowledge that he can demonstrate like in real time. So like let's just say that for every note on a chord, you can visualize it like in a horizontal space.
Yeah, like
so
perfect pitch, perhaps.
No, just like you're looking at a computer screen, and on the screen, every time you hit a note, it moves forward by a small amount, but the note can be registered on a scale that's horizontal. So every time that you play the note B or the note C or the note D, it goes up and down. So he wrote words by playing sounds.
In the program,
so that it demonstrated on the screen the words that he wanted to type. So.
Okay.
Did you see this?
Yeah.
You know,
I know exactly
about
what you're talking about.
I saw that and I was like, this is insane.
It looks perfect. It doesn't look like
irk. Yeah. So, here, let me find it. There's got to be just a YouTube short of it.
Totally.
What's the name of that program, by the way, that he's all in, like, music producers use?
It's like, they have different ones.
It's not Logic.
It's Logic, or it's,
So there's two that tell me how much of a genius is. So there's the one where he does that, and then there's this other video where Jacob Collier shows how he taught himself how to play five different beats with his hands at the same time. So he goes, four time, 4-3 time, 4-2 time, 4-1 time, and then like one. So he figures out how to tap out five different
hand
at the same time. You've seen that too, right? It's
insane. Dude, it breaks my brain. The guy is beyond gifted.
Yeah.
Wow. That's awesome.
I have like four similarly related questions that probably gets us into some music listening.
Okay.
Why is, and they're all based out of, they're all coming from a place of ignorance. So.
I love it.
Why is opera culturally significant? Why is it significant? Why is it,
great.
Why is it important?
Great. So I think that question is a sub-question of why is creativity culturally significant? You know what I mean? It's a subcategory. Right?
So opera is one mode of creativity. Creativity being the primal, the primary question of, if you can answer that, opera makes sense, as does technology, as does real estate, as does architecture, I guess, as does any other avenue of creativity.
So I'm going to answer the question, assuming we've already established that creativity is important.
I think we can universally agree on that, at least in this room.
I think so. Because God has given us a common grace, not just for believers, but for everyone. Music is for, and this is why it's so significant what Kurt Vonnegut said about the only proof of God's existence I need is music. Mm. Like, those who claim not to believe in God, they have no excuse, because God's creation cries out to them about God. Mm. Music being one of the primary ways. And also, you watch something like Lord of the Rings, all the way through. That story speaks to your heart and moves you entirely. The brotherhood and devotion between Sam and Frodo is alone enough to just make you weep. Why? It's a story. Opera is story told through music. Mm. What better way? Martin Luther saying that music is queen over our emotions. Cheer the sad and cool the angry. And so if that's the case, what better way to tell a story through the language of the queen of our emotions? Music. That's opera. And so opera was something that started 424 years ago ish 1600s Italy, 1600s Europe, let's say. Started by the royalty, by the monarchy, by the rich.
Yep.
The king wanted to have an event for all of his, the socialites and the people that were all in his echelon.
King's court.
King's court. Let's have a performance for the king's court. Ah, yes, bring in this singer from over there. Has been trained by, one of the gentlemen. And I will have a court composer. Y'all remember Amadeus, right?
Yeah.
Salieri, poor guy. So, music, opera used to be the high art for the rich. Then, in the 1800s, a shift happened when the composers started writing operas, not about romances between royalty or romances that seemed distant to their culture. You know, they would write like, here's an opera that takes place in Egypt. Ooh. Here's an opera that's like, the hero's journey, and they would write these kind of highfalutin grand operas. There was a shift when they started to write what was called verismo, which is like our version of gritty television that's got realism soaked into it, you know. And so they started doing that in opera, where rather than being a distant story, the story would be like townspeople and the drama that happens between them. A man that falls in love with a woman that's not his wife, and she finds out, and there's a scene, and then All right, and then one of the most famous ones is called Pagliacci. It's the clown that laughs. There's a famous Simpsons scenes that references it. Famous music. It's a story of a traveling band of performers. They do like these funny stage performances. They travel around with their little truck of stuff, and then they set up a stage and they do a performance for the townspeople, and then they go to the next town. Well, the main actor, the main character is one of the actors, and his girlfriend is one of the other actors. And he's a very jealous man, and it turns out that she's cheating on him, and he finds out right before they both have to perform on stage in this town they're in. And he confronts her during the performance on stage, and he kills her. And that's opera. Because something else I haven't said is opera is one of the main places where tragedy is sacred. We can stomach tragedy sometimes from our movies, but we like happy ending.
It's true.
You know, it was a big risk for them to kill Iron Man. It's a tragedy.
Black Hawk Down, anybody?
Haven't seen it. Need to see it.
Yeah.
You
will cry.
So, but in almost every famous opera, somebody dies at the end. And it's usually one of the two people who are in love. And so there's something, but there's because of the music and what the music is saying to you, there's something beautiful and cathartic and so deeply, bittersweetly sad about that ending that it really moves you. And it's really a punch at the end. So I think opera is relevant because I think the past is relevant. I think we should know our cultural history, number one. I think beauty doesn't change. I think taste changes, and I think the culture changes, but beauty is always beauty. And I think opera's music is timeless. We always perform the same operas. There are new ones being written that are okay. They're getting a little bit better. Last 10 years were not so good, but there are some good operas now, but most of them are in the operatic canon. And I think that the stories, though, the reason we do them over and over is the stories are timeless. Stories of love and loss, and stories of longing and heartache, and what's amazing is you'll find in the operatic canon that most of the time these characters, when they're in crisis, turn to God. Because in the culture, in the time that most of these operas were written, between 1750 and 1900, let's say, the culture that the men writing these works were Christian, were God-fearing men. And so their characters would turn to God. And so I think opera is relevant. I think we should...
Do you consider the Psalms to be opera?
Sorry?
Do you consider the Psalms to be opera?
No. I think the Psalms are... poetry, and they're to be sung.
Yeah, they're intended to be sung. Right?
Yeah, so then they are songs. But opera is, the definition of opera is a work that is made up of songs that are woven as a part of the story.
Do you ever speak in an opera?
There are some operas that are dialogue, and then you stop for a dramatic moment,
mm-hmm.
and sing, but most operas that we do, it's all singing all the time. And there are also moments where all of a sudden everything freezes, and this person, there's an outpouring of emotion. And that's not called a song, it's called an aria. And
is it a cappella then?
No. Because opera is 99% of the time is with orchestra, full orchestra. And we sing without microphones.
You kind of answered what are the components of an opera. So there's orchestra, singer, story, wrapped under a performance. How would I recognize a good opera? But you kind of also answered that there's a canon that is just like, okay, those are good operas,
period.
Now, between this Romeo and Juliet and this Romeo and Juliet, how do I know
who's good?
Which one's good?
That's a good question.
In terms of comparing performances, then, or comparing...
I don't know. Yeah. What does my question mean?
To me, your question is about... I like the way you ask questions. To me, your question is about which... performance. How do I tell a good performance?
How do I listen to an opera and know it's good? Or
yes.
How do I watch? Or does it involve watching? Like,
well, this is like, it's like when
is
when,
it secret
when
now?
When were you?
Or is it easily accessible?
No, I think it's easily accessible in the way that.
What was
we were,
what'd you ask? What'd you say?
Is it secret knowledge?
I piggybacked on your question. You asked
good
how
question,
do I know if it's good? And my thought was,
do I have to know music theory?
Do you have to know anything? Like, is there a secret?
Do I have
So, when we were young, and we were growing from boys into men slowly, there was probably a time for each of us where we decided to read books. And we decided to consume media. Not just books, but movies and television and whatever. And I don't know about you, but for me, I said, okay, I'm going to start to read books. I want to read good books. How do I know what book is good? Do I just go pick a random book out of the library? No. I'm either going to ask someone who is older and knows what better, or now in the technology age, I'm going to just do some of the digging that I know how to do to not just say what are the best, but I'm looking for this type of thing from a book.
Goodreads.com, top 100.
There you go. And it's likely that if you go to the top 100, and if you just spin the wheel, so to speak, and you pick one and you read it, let's say it's Grapes of Wrath, or it's a Dostoevsky book. The likelihood is you will have a great experience with that book if you're open to it. Mm-hmm. And your experience will tell you once you've read it, wow, that was a really good book, and I can kind of say why. It kept me in, it had this, it was really engaging, and I got a lot from it, and I wanted to stay with it to the end. I think that there's a similar process for getting into genres of music and art that we are unfamiliar with. It's like, let me talk to somebody who's in it and see where to start. Or let me just do some digging and see if there's a general consensus in the world of these are the great things. And that is certainly the case with opera. We have a canon of the greats. And there are like 10 operas that are like slam dunks every time just because the composer was so inspired. And our canon is made up of probably 60 to 100 operas that are just great. So in listening to that, I would try to find, like, okay, let me try to find the classic recording of this famous opera. I mean, the obvious choice would be La Bohème, or Tosca, or Carmen. I mean, these three operas are just...
You said Carmen?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think I've read that.
Just perfect. Just perfect. You know, the music, the drama of the story, Giacomo Puccini was one of the greatest living Italian composers ever. He came because there's this procession of Italian composer heritage, ancestry. There was Rossini and Bellini and Donizetti. They all were in this bel canto area where it was all led by melody, and it was all about beautiful singing. The drama isn't as good, but boy, is the singing beautiful, and the melodies are written to show off the voice, essentially. And that morphed. Donizetti got into a little bit more drama, dramatic opera, but it was still all about the music. And then Verdi came along. Verdi was... Italians have a national anthem, but really their national anthem is one of the songs that the chorus sings from Verdi's opera about Nebuchadnezzar.
Wow.
And it's when the Jews are in the wilderness and they're all singing about longing for home. Mm. And they sing this chorus, and it's all in unison. And they're just there, and they're all just forlorn in the wilderness, being oppressed by Babylon, you know? And they sing this beautiful chorus. And so Verdi is known as Italy's great nationalist composer. He's Italy's composer. His music, when you hear it, boom, da da dum 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 dum, you hear Italy immediately. You're all of a sudden like, oh my gosh, home. And I'm not even Italian, you know, but I feel it. He like baked homeland into the music. And so he's going back to how he came from the tradition. It was all about the singing for sure, but he took risks with the drama and made it more dramatic, eventually writing one of the most dramatic operas of all time based on the story of Othello. Shakespeare's Othello, who is deceived by his right-hand man into believing that his wife has been unfaithful when she hasn't. But he doesn't believe her because he's been whispered in the ear, like the king in Lord of the Rings, you know, he gets whispered in the ear. And he ends up strangling his wife and then killing himself. And that's Othello. Incredible opera. Gosh, it's amazing. And then there was Verdi, and then there was Puccini. Who was the culmination of all of this. It was music and drama. And it was never like... Yeah, they're just really brilliant. I love every single one of his operas. He wrote La Bohème, Tosca, Madame Butterfly, Turandot, which you all probably have heard Nessun Dorma, which is... familiar to all of us somehow, and then the big high note at the end. So there's this progression of greats, and Italian opera to me is the zenith. There's German opera, there's French opera, there's the great French opera Faust, based on the story of Faust, and Marguerite gets taken to heaven in the end. It's really amazing.
Do I need to know Italian, French, German to enjoy?
To listen and enjoy, no. To understand the drama, yes. And so there are operas online. You'll see when we watch one of these. I think this has subtitles. But if you watch an opera on YouTube, if you find a good, I would find one with subtitles.
Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah.
Is there a reason that opera is not like a commonly enjoyed or accessed thing here, or is it more common in Italy for would a group of guys like us go to the opera in Italy?
In Germany, a group of guys like us would go to the opera.
To pick up chicks or to like enjoy? Like what?
To
would
take our chicks or okay. just to enjoy.
Okay.
It's part of their culture.
Okay, cool.
Literally, it happens every night in almost every city.
Germany?
Yeah. It's baked in.
Okay.
Because Germany was where opera grew up. Italy is horribly disorganized as a country. And so opera happens there, but Italians are just like, take a nap.
Yeah.
That's what they do. And so they don't have their crap together.
I've got friends who moved here from Milan, like dear friends, that I see just about every Sunday at church. And I would love to hear their opinion if I came to them and I said, you people are unorganized. I think you like napping more than you like getting things done.
Now, they're from Milan, and northern Italians, like the Milanese, they are more organized because they're closer to that part of Europe. Seriously. They're colder, you know, up there. And the ones from, like, from Lake
the
Como.
Sicilians, maybe?
But the Sicilians are like, I don't, you know.
I've got some Sicilian
but, like, so. It's just their train system sucks, and the economy sucks. They're just a mess. But if we lived in Germany, it happens all the time.
Is it a rich man's art in Germany, or is it kind of like
no.
an all? It's a free. It's everybody.
People.
Cool.
Because there are the extraordinarily beautiful opera houses, the historic opera houses that have been there for 300, 400 years.
Mm-hmm.
And there are performances that take place in like places like this.
Mm-hmm.
They would push a piano into the big room out there, and then just people would sit, get a beer, and a guy would stand there at the piano and sing for an hour and a half.
Mm-hmm.
And we just, and I went to a few of those events and I was like, wow.
And it would just be easy as walking in, knowing that it's going on.
Just buy a ticket.
$10.
$10.
And a major opera house would be $50.
Yeah, anywhere from 80 euros to 100 euros.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or maybe, and if you are going to one that's extraordinarily popular, 250 euros.
Mm-hmm.
At the Vienna State Opera.
But no more.
No.
So Broadway in New York is more expensive than opera in Germany.
Totally. That's mm-hmm. New York for them.
Well, I mean, but where else are you going to go to Broadway?
True. So... Yeah, it's not the rich man's art there, but
sure.
Here it is because it was not entirely fully transmuted into our culture. It's not because now it's not something we grew up with. There's this barrier to entry, it seems.
But also, what use does a man like on the Oregon Trail have for an opera?
Good question.
You know, like somebody who's trying to forge west. And he's worried about feeding his family and getting killed by Indians, may not have like the highest level of appreciation. For
but I mean, it would be a matter of like telling
yeah,
stories.
Of course, but you know what he does have?
Totally.
His guitar.
You know what he has? He has a harmonica.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So then creates a new genre,
mm-hmm.
right? You
yes. And so mm-hmm. this is not to say, yeah, because most of this has just been a discussion about music
mm-hmm.
itself. Opera is something that is a privilege to get to do. I feel extraordinarily privileged that I get to do this because it takes literally an army to put on an opera.
Yeah.
It takes a village.
I was just thinking, like, what the economics of an opera have got to suck.
It's all in the red. It's all
right,
in the
right,
red.
Right.
Like, it's just... And the thing is... The reason it works in Germany is the state pays for it.
Mm.
Germans pay taxes for opera to happen, for art to take place.
Brilliant!
It's genius, because here we just beg rich people
yeah.
to give us their money
yeah.
and
yeah.
hope that it works. And that's why opera companies are closing around the country
wow.
because COVID just punched everything in the
I
gut.
I've heard yeah. a few stories about that.
And great companies are closing their doors.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a shame. But the thing...
How far do I need to go to like see an opera? Chicago?
We have opera arts.
Here. We have opera here, right?
But I would also say the operas that take place at the MAC in Bloomington are incredible. Indiana University, Jacobs School of Music,
mm-hmm.
opera theater program
mm-hmm.
is equivalent to a fully fledged professional company.
Wow.
They put on better performances than our company here, Indianapolis Opera. No question. Because of their funding.
Could I go see something by end of school year?
Let's see.
Well, we don't have to take the time now to figure that out, but
I'm sure.
Yeah.
Their spring production is coming up.
Oh, cool.
It's interesting you mentioned kind of the forging west now, because that makes me think of the historic Elwood Opera House up in Elwood. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Elwood, it's like straight north of like Fisher's Run, and it's like about 30 minutes out. So, you know, middle of nowhere, cornfields mm-hmm. pretty much. But they actually have an opera house that was built in 1891 there. And the only reason I know about it is I was in a play that went up there. But
are we going?
Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh no. They just did Eugene Onegin, which is a great opera in Russian by Tchaikovsky. But in April, in a month, they're doing Sweeney Todd, which is also an opera.
I didn't know Sweeney Todd was an opera.
It's on the line.
I was gonna say because that feels like Broadway.
It is essentially, but all music theater came from the tradition of opera.
Mm-hmm.
We would not have music theater mm-hmm. that we enjoy. We would not have Wicked.
West Side Story.
We wouldn't have any of those. Mm-hmm. West Side Story is an opera for sure. Because Leonard Bernstein was a serious classical trained, classical singing focused voice writer and composer.
Should I just make it a point to go see whatever Jacob School is doing?
Yes.
Cool. I want to ask the obvious question. What are your thoughts on the album A Night at the Opera by Queen?
It's great. I love it. Yeah, yeah.
It is a pretty cool album.
Yeah.
But I don't...
Have you listened to it as an album experience?
I think I did. Oh, back in my explore the 70s and 80s mm-hmm. phase, but I don't remember much. I know Bohemian Rhapsody is on there, but I like it. I mean, I love his singing. It's obvious when you listen to him that he has classical training. I mean, it's just such
yeah.
easy, beautiful high notes. And it's just great. Ready?
How were you introduced to opera? What was your access point?
High school, I was in choir. They asked me to sing solos. I got encouragement from the choir director. I auditioned for the school musical, Singing in the Rain. And I got the lead. And that was my first stage experience as a lead, I'm the guy singing stuff, getting the girl, whatever. And then they were like, you should take voice lessons. It's okay. So I went to a voice teacher here locally, and she gave me a song from Phantom, which is not opera. Everybody says Phantom of the Opera is an opera. It's operatic for sure. And we should say the Sweeney Todd. It's kind of an opera, but not. And she gave me an opera song, an aria. And then I got to the end of high school, and I was taking lessons with her, and I was like, well, I guess I got to decide what to go to college for. I guess I'll study music. Oh, wait, you can go to college and get a degree in voice performance? Okay. So that was where I really got inundated with. Here's the operas. Here's the canon. Here's the stage. The tradition. What it means to be an opera singer. So that was how I was introduced. It kind of just was a natural process. And then I eventually had a teacher who, he would just give me piles of CDs, and I would just go listen to all of them. And that really was like, shaped my brain. Mm-hmm.
Honestly, it sounds like me and philosophy. Like, almost one-to-one.
Wow.
Just one person was like, or like I tripped into it, and then
yeah.
It was like, bing, and I went, whoa.
Yeah, yeah.
All the CDs, I just...
Yeah, right. Totally.
Cool.
Did you have anything to unlearn vocally?
I still don't think so.
Yeah. Anything that was like a particular challenge for you, like
yes.
Going into it?
Well, going into it, I just had to learn how to sing, period.
Sure.
Yeah. Because it's not easy to sing for 2.5 hours without a microphone and the sound of an orchestra. And to this day, I struggle with thinking that I need more sound. I need to be louder. But it's counterintuitive. You don't get more sound by pushing. You don't get more sound by yelling.
Right.
It's strange,
yeah.
But so there's actually, and it actually has.
You have to turn your head into a megaphone. Like a megaphone starts with this, right?
Yeah, it's the resonance, right?
But it's actually backwards. Mm. It's a backwards megaphone. Because we have all these cavities in our head,
mm-hmm.
and in our chest that resonate, and I can't go ah, ah.
It's like more inside, and now that I'm speaking with my megaphone, you can really, I'm shaking the root,
you know?
And this is the way that I sing, and I feel I don't feel anything on my throat, and now I'm just singing.
That's the whole voice.
Yeah.
I
don't go, now I'm just singing! That's horrible. Ah!
Right.
So but your instinct, especially when in front of an audience, is to say, hear my voice! Like it! Please like me! So it's directly correlated to what I was talking about being insecure and wanting people to like you. So actually choosing to take your power and just let your voice be what it is. Choose to be willing to just be who you are. And let that be enough and speak for itself. Choose to let your meager elements be what they are.
Yeah.
And the voice will speak for itself.
You mentioned that there was some opera that had made its way into Simpsons, and I feel like I've got a memory of Sideshow Bob being one of the singers. Like that particular character had a turn at singing, and that his voice was actually really, really nice.
I don't
Is
remember.
That, who was it that was singing? And
I think it was Homer, who was like,
never mind. So it's not edifying.
No.
Culturally.
No.
Shall we listen to this guy?
Yeah, so when I told my friend I was doing this, mm-hmm. I was going to talk about this stuff and play some things. He was like, don't play too much, Ganson. But I have a few things that I think are just perfect. And
from the perspective of the performance itself? Or both, the music?
Both.
This is really reminding me of comic books and why I'm reading comic books. I made the joke earlier, but I actually am reading comic books because it's a visual, there's a visual component to the written word, and it's the combination of the two that unlocks like a completely new way of communicating a story. I think that comic books have been like I've gotten really dense like kind of things out of them, and they're sticking better. Like they're better memorable, like because there's a visual component to it.
Yeah, it's just it's really cool to think about. I mean, might be reducing opera a little bit, but or elevating comics too much, but whatever. But to take two.
Yeah.
Senses and
yes.
Or I guess
maybe underline a story
yes.
with a sensation.
Yeah. Right? Because story will change the world. Mm-hmm. Like it has
yes.
changed the world.
And
yeah.
you can choose the medium
and how to put that in front
through
of
which
yeah.
you tell the story.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Some of our and our stories are, and to your point, our stories are just not good right now. Like they're not
they're uninspired.
Yeah.
And they're all
right.
They're feelings. They're about feelings and led by
yeah.
our feelings and
yeah.
feelings and feelings.
Yeah.
It's like that only goes so far.
Yeah.
It actually falls flat.
Yeah. I'll shut this door unless you think leaking out some inspiration is a good thing.
Yeah, no,
yeah.
Shut it.
Yeah, shut it?
Yeah, yeah. So the first one, this is rather short and this is kind of what I was talking about the shape of this music from start to finish. It's just like, it's symmetrical. So this is a piece by Handel, written almost 400 years ago. And this was the style of music that they loved. And this one was, this one was beautiful because with the vocal line, he's painting a picture. This is Xerxes singing about the beautiful tree that he's under and the shade that it's giving him from the hot sun. And it's a very simple idea, but the vocal line paints the picture of the shade and the tall branch of the tree. It's very... very beautiful, and there's a word for that that they taught me in music theory, which I forget.
Dang, that swagger.
He's 26.
That motherfucker's got swagger.
26 with gray hair.
This
is from
a concert at the Great Bolshoi Theatre. What sort of music particularly attracts him?
Я много пою итальянских арий из оперы. Мне кажется, что это для каждого вокалиста должно являться школой. И сама итальянская музыка, она располагает правильному пению, итальянский язык. И просто я очень люблю эту музыку, и в частности композитора Верди Донизетти.
Я
очень много стал петь этой музыки и стал замечать, что мой голос...
Thank you.
Beginning, middle, end, and the return of a melody that you hear in the beginning, and then comes back at the end, and then he ties a bow on it, and it's home. That's that shape, and this was all pre the Romantic period and everything, and this was like very, they loved the symmetry at that time, and. There were no weird choices in music, like, didn't get too wonky. It would only, like, suggest, like, ooh, that's a little bit out of the pocket, but now we're back in it. Their deviations from the symmetry would only be, like, suggestive. Mm-hmm. But it was always in this beautiful framework, and that was why it was, like, high art, you know. Mm-hmm. You think about the classical piece, that's like, this is the equivalent of the Statue of David. It's entirely symmetrical, one piece, you know, just...
Cool. Gotta get going.
Gotta go.
All right.
Cool, man.
Catch you later.
Thank you for the wonderful talk.
Yeah, of course.
Good seeing you, man.
Good to see you, man. Hope you enjoy some classical music.
Yeah, I'll check it out.
See ya.
That's it.
More.
Yeah.
So this is from the Romantic period. This music. This is from a French composer named Charpentier. And this is a performance from the Metropolitan Opera House, the biggest opera company, most famous opera company in America. They would do these big concerts in the 80s and 90s. Where they would bring all the stars in to New York, and each star would walk onto the stage gracefully in a beautiful dress or in a nice tuxedo and would sing a famous aria from a famous opera. It was a gala concert.
Wow.
And it was like a night of with the stars. Mm-hmm. And the most famous conductor would be at the podium conducting the greatest orchestra in America. And these are events that just we don't get anymore because we don't have the stars that we used to have. We don't have the singers that we used to have because we don't have the devotion that we used to have to this art form. Systemic thing. But anyway, I love this music, and this is Renee Fleming, who you may have heard of. She's a very famous opera singer, and this is just incredible music. something that, so you can tell that the music is different, right? It's not as simple. It goes, really goes somewhere, and then it comes back. She sang something similar in the beginning that she sang at the end, and then it kind of tied in well with it at the end. And that music is, as I said about Puccini when I was talking about the Italian composers, that music is entirely about what the character is experiencing. She's singing about how her dream is coming. Her dream is coming true. And so it's really about what she's going through, and it's about the singing, like the virtuosity that you see there. And something I see when I watch that, I'm like, wow. These people make the extraordinarily difficult seem so easy. Which is what we see, it's what I see when I watch Michael Jordan play. It's what I see when, fill in the blank. You know, you see someone who, and it's just amazing.
Yeah, chills, really.
That's yeah, cool. Right?
Wow.
Yeah. That's
incredible.
I'll be right back again.
Yeah.
I went for a run this morning and I drank a lot of water.
Have you seen an opera?
It's been a minute, but
last one
I saw
nice.
was Aida, I think. And,
wow.
Yeah, the Chicago Symphony.
Cool.
So, yeah,
in Chicago.
Yeah, Chicago. Yeah.
Nice. When was that?
I should say sorry. No, Chicago Symphony. They're a couple over there.
Yeah.
In Chicago. That was that was probably 20 years ago now.
Wow.
Yeah, I think I was maybe not even in high school. Then I was probably in junior high. But it was interesting because my twin sister is a dancer. You know, she was grew up taking ballet lessons and everything. And she worked with a choreographer who was actually the choreographer for the lyric opera. Did some of the choreography for some of their operas. And just to kind of support it, we went down to see one of the shows. It was really cool.
Oh,
so,
cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Talk about,
production.
That's the one that's in Egypt, you know? It's like,
yeah.
It's a little out there, you know? But the music is extraordinary.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
I haven't played a tenor yet. I feel like I have to.
Sure.
So this guy, I went to an event where they were honoring his work and his life in the opera business. And he's an Italian guy. He was in a wheelchair. And he's got these thick bottle, Coke bottle glasses. But he has a voice that, for me, is just out of this world. Because again, these people are just developing their voices without microphone, without amplification. And so if you have a voice that cuts over the orchestra, that's the winning voice.
Yeah.
And this guy's old and he looks nerdy, but boy, can he sing. This is an aria that is from Puccini's La Fanciulla del West, which means the girl from the Golden West. Puccini wrote a western after writing an opera about Bohemians in France, and then an opera about, which is essentially Miss Saigon, Madame Butterfly, the Navy American soldier sleeps with a Japanese girl and then leaves her and she has a child, that's Madame Butterfly. Turandot's an opera in China. And so he wrote an opera in the West, from San Francisco or whatever. In the Western, you know, like the Clint Eastwood spaghetti Western days. And this is the aria that he sings, the lead character sings before he's about to get hung. He's a bandit and he's fallen in love with a girl, and they were trying to keep their love secret, but then they were found out, and he's hated by the local town guy, and he's actually innocent, but they believe he did this thing, and they're going to kill him, and he's never going to get to see her again, and she doesn't know that he's about to be executed, and he sings this aria, "I hope that she'll believe that I'm far away and I'm free." Yeah. Yeah. Crazy voice.
Wow.
Just, I mean, 60.
No way.
60.
No way. Wow.
Crazy voice. Do you guys know what a theremin is?
Theremin, that's like a, isn't that an electric?
It's an instrument that gets played through waves.
Yeah, right?
It's an instrument that you don't touch.
Yeah. It is like an electric field.
Yes,
right?
It's an electric field.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then you manipulate the sound.
Yeah.
And it's not opera, but I thought this would be interesting because,
yeah.
Again, it's a display of virtuosity and it's divine.
And Ganson, did you play any instruments?
Piano.
Yeah? Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. What kind of style do you classical?
This stuff,
like,
yeah. I have to learn my scores, and so it was very beneficial for me to learn piano. And then during COVID, I made a bunch of videos at the piano, singing and playing, you know, doing my thing.
That's awesome.
When did you start learning piano?
When I was like a kid, they took me to like the neighborhood piano class. One of our neighborhood people taught, and then I just started playing by myself in high school. I mean, I knew basics. I took a little bit of theory in high school, but then I just found YouTube videos of guys who had put a camera over the piano, and then they would put the notes, and I would just, and they would teach like a Beatles song or Billy Joel, you know, whatever, and I would just be like, oh, and that would teach you the shape of the song, and how to go from one chord to the next, and here's how to kind of play the rhythm.
Do you write any music yourself?
No.
Do you improvise a lot?
I used to write a little bit, but... It's a different... That's a different thing,
yeah.
You know? But...
How would you shape a... My baby is almost 1.5. What was good about your learning experience, and what would you change to optimize it, or make it better, or more efficient, or more enjoyable, or more attractive as a kid?
The thing that touched me the most, and influenced my music love the most, was when my mom would play a song that she really loved, and it would make her cry.
What kind of music was that?
Soul music. She would play like Aretha Franklin, like Whitney Houston. One of these ballads that just was a banger, and it would just move her, and I just saw how these specific songs like really moved my mom, and I was like, wow. And then I would let music move me. I would look for it. I would look for how music would make me feel. And so I think, to put that in a sentence, it's important for kids to see what their parents love. Yeah. To witness rather than to be taught, because more is caught than taught. I was a witness to what my mom loved. And then when I was growing up, I started digging around in the CD collection. And I found a Frank Sinatra CD and an Elvis CD that I turned it on, and I was like, whoa. And I just closed the door to my room, and I would just play it over and over and over again. So... there's nothing I would change about it, because, I mean, I love what I love now. And I think that the most important thing were those seeds that were planted by them. And also, my parents, like my Nana, took me to an opera at a very young age. And took me to an opera concert at a rich lady's house who was having a singer sing at a piano.
How old are you?
7, 8, 9. And it was time to go after the concert, and Nana was like, "Where's Ganson?" And I was like, underneath the piano. She was like, "Come on, Ganson, it's time to go." I was like, "Nana, I don't want to leave. The music's so beautiful, I want to cry." So there were intentional experiences from them, going to things together to experience something, to see something. Especially for my Nana, who loved and was a supporter of the local opera company here for a long time. So it's a mixture.
If your mom would have teared up to like Dolly Parton, and your first CD that you discovered was Michael Jackson, do you think your trajectory with music would have gone a different direction, not classical?
I don't know, but I think not. Because my first vocalists were Frank and Elvis. Mm-hmm. The guys who made me want to sing were Frank and Elvis.
You'd heard Dolly Parton before, you'd heard Michael Jackson before, but these two were the ones that spoke to you.
I think I had maybe heard like Billie Jean and been like, ooh, wow.
Uh-huh.
And
Whiz Pop.
Yeah, and sure, I don't think I had heard Dolly Parton. Uh-huh. because my mom wasn't really a Dolly Parton girl. But it was just the timing of it. Just like I had heard songs and I had jammed out to Jeremiah was a bullfrog, you know, like I had jammed out to music as a kid, and the way kids do, that you just kind of get into it a little bit. But when I heard Frank tell a story with his voice, when I heard Frank really say something with his voice, and when I heard Elvis, when I felt the way his singing made me feel, there was so much emotion in Elvis's singing. Treat me like a fool, treat me mean and cruel. I mean, it's like, oh, I'm in. From the moment he starts singing, I'm like, oh, you know? So, yeah, I wouldn't have it any other way.
If somebody said, here's $150,000, here's $200,000.
Don't do that to me.
Every year. Consistently.
Stop.
I just need you to pop into the studio every once in a while, get on stage with us, and you're in a band. A pop band. Would you take that? You could. You could do it.
If it fit my schedule, yes.
No more opera.
No. No, because, and this is
what if there was like unlimited, like you could sing, you could write your own songs, you can have your, it can be virtuous in a celebratory, like a celebrity-esque way, accessing the masses?
No. Because it's not, so, and this is what's difficult. This is what it means to be devoted.
You could do what Elvis did for you. You could do what Aretha Franklin does for your mom.
Let me finish this thought and then we'll go there. Because right now my career has more momentum than it ever has. But right now I'm still looking at maybe 20, 30 grand this year. Maybe. But I every time I've thought about stopping and trying to do something else to make more money, to eventually support a family, God punches me in the face with, I gave you this for a reason. What am I going to do? Hide it under a bushel. I am convinced that I'm supposed to keep going on this path. In a way of saying, I feel like God keeps revealing to me over and over again that I was wired for this. So, and I haven't gotten to the end yet. I feel like I can't deviate until I find out what's at the end of the path. And I chose to start, so I'm going to finish what I started. But also, I didn't even choose it. God showed me that this is the path I should walk. So there's something about this being my gift that keeps me on this path, no matter how difficult it's been. Boy, it's been tough. Before this year, I was scrambling trying to start my career, trying to go to Germany, trying to break into that scene. Extraordinarily difficult to do that as an American when you don't live there and you don't really know anybody. So, but give it all up after I've put so much in to sing pop songs. I don't think I could do it. I want to keep trying to do the hardest thing, which is to keep going. And there's got to be a middle ground where I can sustain myself financially and do it. And the further I go with this, I mean, I'm going to make more money this year as a singer than I've ever made. It's not $100,000, but I'm getting more checks for being the lead singer at opera houses this year than I ever have. I'm like, whoa, what's next year going to be? Can't wait to see. Ask me this question in 5 years. I'll probably say, I'll just do it on the side. I'll probably say something like half yes, you know? In that, as the path opens up and changes and I get out of my parents' house, find a place to live, start to sustain myself with what I make as a singer, let's see. Maybe it'll make sense to go sing concerts with Andrea Bocelli, the most famous tenor right now. He's just doing concerts everywhere. He's blind. Maybe it makes sense to mix it up. But right now, I am convinced I must stay the course. I guess that's an answer to your question. So, yeah.
I think that's a common like dilemma in early 30s.
Yeah.
Like I don't think you're alone. Mm-hmm. I think you're in a niche. Like, I think you're a little bit more niche than real estate or tech or whatever.
Yeah.
So the perceived difference is greater.
Yeah.
But, because I think about it all the time. I'm like, fuck, what the fuck do I care about real estate for? Like, I don't care about houses. I really don't. I don't. I care about you, and I care about your family, and I care about you. I've got a family that I'm helping right now. They just had their fifth child. Okay? They have one bathroom. Okay. I know that real estate can fix that. But I don't care about real estate. I care about you guys. These are insane conditions to be raising a family. And you guys are way too good of a family not to have three bathrooms.
Yeah.
I have three bathrooms.
Right.
It's like, It's like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Like, I would love to go back to school, but I might be on the other side. I might be on the sellout side. Right, that's not open for debate. That's not a conversation, but the tension is the conversation.
Yes,
the tension of like my skill, my desire, my ability to access philosophy differently than most people. That's substantial. I'm doing applied philosophy in some sense. Is that pop music? Maybe.
Maybe. And, you know, Jim Rohn said, it's all risky.
Yeah.
Wait till you get the bill for not risky.
Right. Right. Well, my principal broker, I met with him like a year ago, probably to the day. And it was my first time sitting down and sitting with him. And he was like, at the end of lunch, it was so goofy that he said this, because we just had a great conversation. It was like really good conversation. Some real estate, some life, whatever was going on at the time, this time last year, I don't remember what.
Yeah.
And he was like, you think differently. Like, you are thinking differently than other people. Like, you're philosophical or something. And he has no idea my background. Like, he has no clue. And I was like, wow. He's like, you have to leverage that in your business. I said, double wow. He's like, because the people who think like you or enjoy those kinds of thoughts, even if they don't think like you, will gravitate towards you in droves and in ways that you can't slow them down. Like, they will run you over, like out of a frenzy for you. Like, I would never have thought, because I'm over here self-conscious about, like, I'm so niche, I'm so different, I'm outside, I'm isolated, I'm nobody to the rest of the world, and I look like different than other realtors, for example, or whatever. And I'm so self-conscious, I'm nobody. And he's like, no, you need to double down on that, on that exact thing, double down on it. And I was just like, that's nutty. And he has no idea who I am, right? I had no idea who he was. I'm just having lunch. And thus was born 2 Minute Tuesday and shit like that, right? Yeah. This and stuff like that. Right? So I don't know, I would underscore that. I like your answer. I think that's
And if I end up if it ends up not working out, great. I'll do something else, and I have plenty.
I'll go do the default easy thing.
Yeah,
better than anybody else.
And, like, it won't be
the easy thing for me.
It won't
me,
be the easy
know?
Thing, but I have skills that'll make it easier.
Yeah,
because I am a people person, and I have an organized brain, and I'm detail oriented. Blah blah blah. I can do all that.
You would run circles around any dueling piano guy. You know what I mean?
Probably like, not though. But yes, I gotcha.
But that's not. But that isn't the point. That's not the point. The point is to glorify God. And if you were doing philosophy, you wouldn't be glorifying God as because it's not you.
Right.
If I did opera, I wouldn't be glorifying you. I'd be fucking screaming in a microphone, which is exactly not opera.
No. So I'm looking for what God has gifted me in, and I'm stepping into that.
Yeah.
And turns out that it's the hardest thing, even though it's the thing I'm best at, because it's making me face all my demons. If I were doing the easy thing, that would be too easy. Like, on one hand, this is what I'm best at, but it's also, it's that battle of, am I doing it for me or am I doing it for God? Like, it's putting me in the hot seat to deal with that. Because no matter how much I talk, my flesh is still flesh. And so it's always this push and pull. And so I get to glorify God in this, and I get the challenge of working through the problem. I have no choice but to look it in the face, you know, and to deal with it. So, I don't know if that makes sense, but,
cool.
I think we did it.
Cool, good.
This was awesome, man.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, hey, this was fun for me to, think about and, talk about and look at those quotes, which are so amazing and so inspiring.